For the last 20,000 years, Aboriginal Tasmanians have been collecting colorful, glassy stones they come across on the western side of their island. They've made these glittering rocks into tools and ornaments, and they trade them far and wide. But they're not the only ones who have become fascinated with these stones. Researchers now call this material Darwin Glass, and it's helping them understand some pretty dramatic days in Earth's history. It could even be the key to finding life on other planets. While we know that people have been fascinated by these shiny little rocks for a long time, it's taken us a while to get to the bottom of what they are and how they got to Tasmania. And it's not because they're scarce or limited to this island. People have found these rocks on every continent except South America and Antarctica, and they've even been recovered from the bottom of the ocean. Our first written record of these rocks comes from China in 900 BCE, where they were called inkstones from the thunder gods, because they were easiest to find after rainstorms. They had a brilliant luster and rang like a bell when they were struck. Clearly, these were no ordinary rocks. But it wasn't until the late 19th century that they started to catch the eye of Western scientists too. The glassy rocks are predominantly rounded, pitted pieces of silicate glass, and they were named tektites after the Greek word tektos, meaning melted. They tend to be found scattered among the normal rocks of an area, not in any big clusters or centralized deposits, so there wasn't much info to help anyone figure out how they formed in the first place. One early theory suggested that tektites were similar to another kind of glass-like rock. Obsidian is a volcanic rock that solidifies so quickly that the minerals don't form into distinct crystals, but rather freeze into an amorphous glass. So scholars wondered whether tektites could just be pieces of obsidian that weathered into their funky shapes. But the chemistry and the texture of these tektites didn't match up to any known sources of obsidian, so that idea got thrown out. Some suggested that tektites were actually man-made, left over from ancient forgotten civilizations who had learned to smelt ores, and in that process left glassy, slag-like rocks behind. But it turned out that tektites are way too old to have been made by any humans. The absolute earliest evidence of smelting comes from about 6,000 BCE, and the youngest tektites that we know of are more than 100,000 years old. If a human had made them, we would have figured out smelting before we got to, like, agriculture. So researchers wondered if the chunks were made by lightning strikes, melting and fusing silicate-rich sediments into a glass. But since lightning happens pretty much all over the world, if it was making these tektites, you'd expect to find them everywhere. But global tektite distribution is uneven. Finally, scientists suggested that the tektites weren't from our planet at all, and were actually pieces of the moon that had been hurled towards the Earth by, like, volcanic eruptions or impacts or something. This theory was popular for a while in the middle of the 20th century, since no other terrestrial explanation seemed to fit. But when the Apollo program brought back the first samples of lunar rock down to Earth, we could see that they had a totally different composition. So tektites might be weird, but they weren't out of this world weird. Although this extraterrestrial origin idea might be the closest we got to the real answer before scientists cracked it. Because while the stuff they're made of is all homegrown, the way they got made isn't. See, tektites are formed by meteorite impacts here on Earth. When a large enough space rock makes it through our atmosphere and hits the Earth's crust, it can generate shock pressures of up to 100 gigapascals, or a million times atmospheric pressure. Plus, the impact can create temperatures up to 50,000 degrees Celsius, nearly 10 times the temperature of the surface of the Sun. That is more than enough energy to hurl rocks away from the impact site and to melt them as they go. Those blobs of molten rock can then travel up to 80 kilometers into the stratosphere before raining back down to Earth. The smaller pieces cool and freeze in a variety of shapes while still in the air, while larger pieces finish solidifying as slumped chunks on the ground. And in the deep sea, microtektites have been found that are less than a millimeter across. As a result, a single meteorite impact will create a strewn field of tektites that are all basically the same age and made of the same stuff, meaning that no two tektite fields are exactly alike. As a result, many tektites have earned local names after the places they're most commonly found. So we have Georgialite in North America, Moldavite in Central Europe, Ivorite in Western Africa, and Australite in You guessed it, Australia. So when Westerners saw the tektites in Tasmania in 1914, they were named Darwin Glass, after nearby Mount Darwin. They consist of irregular fragments and twisted chunks up to 10 centimeters across. And they often have these tiny bubbles trapped inside that give them a flowy internal structure. Those bubbles and whirls would have formed when soft, semi-molten glass landed and slumped after its flight through the air. Using the proportions of radioactive elements in the glass, researchers estimated that the tektites in Tasmania date to about 816,000 years ago, which is the approximate date of the impact that formed them as well. And even though they're all the same age, individual pieces of Darwin glass can look quite different, ranging in color from white through light and dark green to black. Researchers think this happened because there were two different rock types at the impact site. Quartzite minerals resulted in white tektites, and mud-rich shales made the shades of green. The more shale in the mix, the darker the color would be. And if there was any doubt remaining about how Darwin glass formed, researchers also found a smoking gun inside them called coesite. This is a form of quartz that can only form under the extremely high temperatures and pressures created by these impacts. So there's nothing else that we know about that could have made the Darwin glass. And once researchers were able to identify the location of that meteor impact, they learned a couple of pretty crucial things. For starters, they found that the spot where this meteor crashed down over in the west of Tasmania was really swampy at the time of impact. And this swampy impact zone did more than just make a ton of glass. It also opened up an exciting possibility for paleontologists and exobiologists searching for clues of past life here and on other worlds. In 2013, scientists were using powerful microscopes to look for crystals inside Darwin glass when they found spherical pockets, or inclusions, up to a fifth of a millimeter in diameter. And inside those pockets, they found organic molecules like cellulose, lignin, and protein, all of which are biological polymers that are made by plant life here on Earth. So these are probably ancient plant fragments from the prehistoric forest and swamp that got mixed up into the molten rock before it hardened. The heat of the melted glass would have boiled the water inside that plant material almost instantly, creating a frothy, honeycomb texture of pockets that was frozen inside the glass when it solidified. Because of that instant isolation, the organic material inside the glass hadn't even decayed, since you usually need oxygen to make decomposition happen. So these tiny bubbles preserved the organic molecules basically unchanged, similar to how insects are preserved inside ancient amber. As a result, tektites like Darwin glass have the potential to be time capsules for what life was like when they formed. And since meteorites have struck the Earth for pretty much its entire history, those time capsules could help to fill the gaps in our knowledge of early life on Earth. Not only that, but glassy tektites have also been found on the surface of Mars, a planet whose surface is covered in impact craters. And if any of those impacts coincided with life on the Big Red Planet, those glass nodules might even preserve a record of it. But there is one more exciting possibility. What if, along with preserving ancient life, tektites could transport it too? The basic idea is that if there's life on one planet and something smacks into that planet hard enough to send debris flying into space, maybe some of those living things could hitch a ride, or at least their organic molecules. The problem is, this so-called panspermia theory is hard to prove. We know it's possible to get chunks of rock thrown onto other celestial bodies from a collision because we have meteorite fragments here on Earth that originated on Mars and the Moon. But there didn't seem to be a way for anything biological to survive that kind of trip. Meteorites are exposed to the vacuum of space, and the heat and pressure of ejection and impact would be especially destructive to vulnerable organic materials. But the plant matter trapped inside Darwin glass suggests that it could be possible. The bubbles already show that the organic material can survive the heat of initial impact. If the collision happened quickly enough, then tektite fragments, along with their encapsulated organic cargo, could be flung off the planet altogether. Then the living material inside the glassy bubbles would be protected from the vacuum of space and to some extent the heat of re-entry and impact on another body as well. Within impact glass like this, biomolecules could have been seeded to Earth billions of years ago, or could have been delivered from Earth to other planets in the solar system whenever it was bombarded by meteorites too. Now, to be clear, this is all speculative. It's more of a thought experiment for how panspermia could work. But that thought experiment gained a whole new level of details thanks to these shiny little tektites. And SciShow Rocksbox subscribers can look forward to receiving their own biomolecule escape pod when this month's sample of Darwin Glass hits your mailbox. But watch out, because I hear they land pretty hard. Every month, our Rocksbox members receive a quality, ethically sourced mineral or fossil right to their door, along with some fun facts about your new rock. If you want to learn more, you can head over to complexly.store/rocks or use the link in the description to sign up for the waiting list. Thanks for watching.